You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Dr. Pamela Kreiser, and welcome back to NCR 507, which is Research Design and Interpretation. Now, today we're going to talk about a special statistical model called the chi-square. Sometimes people think about this as being a very simple test, but I think it's a very useful one when we have the presence of two categorical variables. So let's take a look at the chart that we've been using for our class, and let's evaluate where this fits into the overall picture of the test that we're doing. So as you can see here on the chart, we have an example of a way to think about what test I should be using when I have different types of data that are involved in the process. And so let's take a look at this chart. And one of the things that we notice first off is that we have the independent variables up here. And so in almost every case, we have one independent variable and then one dependent variable. And so as you're looking at this chart, I want you to notice that we can look at the types of data that each specifies and then know what test we're going to use. So the first test that we're looking into, which is the one we're going to start with today, is this chi-square test. It also has an old name called cross-tabulation, and that's the old name for it that we used to see a number of years back. We would see people refer to it sometimes as cross-tabs or cross-tabulation. So when we think about using the chi-square, we notice that both of the variables involved are categorical in nature. Now, this is important to see because sometimes we get into situations when we only have two categorical variables. And what does that mean? That we could have all kinds of different categories in each of the variables, but we only have two. And what are we looking at? We're looking to see if these variables are independent from each other, meaning they don't have dependency. And so that is essentially what our chi-square is. Now, as we move to the next screen, we can take a look at the setup of this example that we're going to talk about today. So this example is focusing on analyzing the question of when males and females might take a basic statistics class. Okay, so you can see that we have it set up in a series of boxes. And so we see the independent variable right here, and this is gender. Okay, so that's our independent variable. And then we have the dependent variable, and that's the year, the academic year. So we'll just put year, right? And this is the dependent variable. And we're going to see that we have five different choices of when someone might take their basic statistic course. And so we can see the dependent variable. Now, one thing to notice is that as we talk about chi-squares, we actually talk about it in terms of the levels available inside the variables. So here we see one, two levels. So we would identify that on this we'd have two levels, and then here we have five levels, right? And so we would say there's five here. So we would call this a 2 by 5 chi-square. And so what does that mean? That means that it produces 10 boxes, and you can see those boxes here, right? So it gives us 10 possible options of where the data could go. And so we would evaluate the 2 by 5 chi-square and say that these are the possible boxes. Now, as you take a look at this chart, you can see this question up at the top. So if we asked 100 people when they took a basic statistics class, we could analyze where we would expect to see the data. And so that's basically how we think of the chi-square, is we start off by looking at what would be the expected distribution of 100 participants. So let's go ahead to the next slide. And we can see that all things being equal, and we know it wouldn't perfectly come out like this, but we can see that if we didn't think that these variables operated together, we would expect there to be about 10 cases in all of the 10 cells, making it 100 in total, right? And so if we asked 50 males and 50 females to answer when they took a basic statistics class, then we would look and say, okay, we expect it to look something like this. Of course, it wouldn't look exactly like this, but we would expect it to look something like this. So when we actually collect the data, then what we are doing is comparing to this notion right in front of us. Now look at this notion, it's all equal. And this is essentially the null hypothesis. This is that we would expect there not to be really any differences. And so as you look at this page, you would think about it as representing more like the null. Now let's take a look at the next slide. When I collect the data, so let's say I get 50 males and females to answer, I actually get the following distribution. So you can see this is the data that we've now collected. And so as we look at it, we notice a couple things. And this is something that I want you to think about when you're doing any statistical analysis. Don't forget to ask the common sense questions, and that is to look at the data and say, is anything noticeable? And so when I look at it, and when you look at it, a couple of things might jump out. The first one that jumps out is this number. And I notice that all of a sudden I have a lot higher value in the senior male box than I would have expected. Remember, I was expecting around 10 if all things were equal. And then I also notice that I only have one in the male junior box. And that's kind of interesting also because it's pretty different from what I was expecting to see. And then here on the females, I see that freshman year, 20 females indicated that they took a basic statistics class. So I'm looking at all three of these boxes just from a common sense point of view, saying, I wonder, they look different to me. I wonder if they're significantly different. And of course, you hear that phrasing all the time from me. It's really asking the question, yeah, they look different, but are they significantly different? Because if they aren't significantly different, then we would essentially say they are not different enough. And so let's go ahead and go up to the next slide and talk about this. And this is the concept that we have to introduce here. And it's a concept called the degrees of freedom. So whenever you're using a model, you need to calculate the degrees of freedom. Now, lucky for us, the computer will do this for us. But I want to go over our example so that we can identify this pretty easily. So when we talk about degrees of freedom, we're talking about the way the scores could possibly vary. What does that mean? That means that the scores are free to vary a little bit of ways in terms of the rows and the columns. And so our calculation for the degrees of freedom is the following formula. Rows minus one times columns minus one. So if you think about it, we had a 2 by 5 chi-square. And so all we have to do is subtract one from that number and from that number, right? And then we get 4 degrees of freedom. And so as you look at it, then you can identify that all I have to do is take the 2 by 5, you saw the 2 by 5 chi-square, and I subtract 1 from the number 2 and 1 from the number 5, I multiply them, and I get this number of 4 degrees of freedom. And this is the number that I'm going to use to evaluate, or in our case, the computer will use to evaluate whether something is significant or not. Now let's go ahead and look at the next page. And here we can see some basic data that has been inputted into the SPSS data matrix. Now, in a different video, I will explain how to conduct this analysis. It's very simple, so you can look for that video on how to actually run it yourself at home. But as we look at the data, we know that the data go all the way down to 100. So we see here's just up to 20-something, but we know that it would go down as far as 100 cases. And we also know that we have two categorical variables here. So we have gender and year. And this is just how the data are put in to show us the results and so we can do the comparison on SPSS. So let's go ahead and go to the next slide. So after you run the chi-square test, then you're going to get a very important box that gives you the chi-square result. And remember I said to take a look at that other video as you're evaluating how to run that on SPSS, you'll be able to see that. So let's take a look at these results. And one of the things we know is that we actually care about 4 of the numbers here. So we care about these numbers. So I'm going to circle them for you, and then we'll talk about them. Okay, so the first number is, the chi-square value. That's this value right here. And we see that that number is 22.362. Now, I look at these numbers all the time, and I'm noting personally that looks like a pretty high number. So I'm guessing that it'll be significant. But of course, the computer will evaluate that for me. I know that my N here is 100. So that's how many cases that I have. I know that I have 4 degrees of freedom. So I can see that here. And we just calculated that. Remember, it's a 2 by 5 chi-square, resulting in 4 degrees of freedom. And then here is my significance level. That's this top number here. And so I see that this is P is less than 0.05, which is great. So I do have, in fact, a significant difference. And so that's very important because I want to note that my results are different, significantly different from what I would expect to be an equal distribution. So let's take a look at how we would actually write this out. If I were writing it in terms of a research project, I'd put that chi symbol there. And then the next number I'm going to write is the degrees of freedom. And then I'm going to write the n. And then I'm going to write the chi-square value. And then I'm going to write the significance level. And in our case, it is significant. So here I have the chi-square, and I have 4 degrees of freedom. I have my n equals 100. I have my chi-square value, 22.362. And I have a significant result, p is less than 0.05. So as you are writing out this result, you know the proper way to report the chi-square results here in terms of the writing mathematically. Now, the last box we want to talk about is this box down below. And this box down below is the phi and the Kramer's V. And here, again, we see significance. So these are the special, it's looking at the cell comparisons. And here, we see that P is less than 0.05. Less than 0.05. So that gives me some more specifics about my model. So what does this mean in total, then? That males and females differ significantly in when they take the basic statistics class. And so when we were talking about the null, we said they wouldn't differ, would be the null hypothesis in the case of our example. But we knew that if we use the confidence level of 95%, leaving us with the p-value of 0.05, we could judge this chi-square to be significant after we ran the results. And we see all these four numbers that actually matter. So what does that tell us? That tells us that these data do differ in terms of when individuals take the class, and we can say that with confidence because we saw this p-value is actually less than, way less than 0.05, so we know it's not more significant, by the way, it just is or isn't, but we judge that it is a significant result. Now, when you're thinking about the results, of course, we can say that these variables now we know are not independent, meaning, and that was what the test was, so they act together. And as we think about this, then, of course, your job as the researcher is then to explain what these results mean. And so as you think about the explanation, your task is to explain why the results the way they are. Now, you might decide that when we're talking about the results, that these might be due to the fact that men and women perhaps approach the academic scheduling differently. Maybe this is reflective of that males prefer to take more specialty courses in the beginning of their academic career, and maybe women are more inclined to take more general education requirements. So that result that we just saw might stimulate further research. And so it could be due to that. So we might think about that. It could be that perhaps men are encouraged to believe that they don't need further math education. And so sometimes we see stereotypes in our society about expectations regarding something like math or science. And so this result could be reflective that perhaps males don't automatically identify their need for additional math education. And so that might be why they might not enroll in that class during a certain year, during an earlier year. Now, your task, of course, is to explain these results. But as you heard my phrasing, make sure you understand that when you talk about the results, you can't say for sure that it's due to any of those reasons. So you want to, when you're writing up results related to the chi-square or any of the models we're going to do in the class, you want to talk about that it might be due to something, or it could be a result of something, or it might be because of. And as you talk about it in that way, then you leave room for some other explanations. Because of course, we can't definitively say it's for sure one reason. That would be not probability testing. That would be knowing for sure the reasons for different things. And so as we evaluate the results from the chi-square, we know that we're looking for the independence of the variables. And as we saw in our case, they were not independent. There was a significant difference. and that we saw males took the class significantly later in their academic career, females took it significantly earlier. But let's just wrap up and talk about the chi-square in review to make sure we understand it. Remember, the chi-square involves two categorical variables. So we know the kind of data measurement that we have to have. We know that we have the independent and dependent variable. We know that we're looking at a null hypothesis that expects there not to be any difference. We know that when we get a significant chi-square result, we're seeing a significant difference from what we expected to see. And that is the math behind the chi-square, looking at what we observed differing from what we expected to see. And so the great thing is that SPSS will calculate that for you and give you the results that we talked about. So that wraps up our episode on the chi-square. And I hope that you found it interesting, and I'll look forward to seeing that in some of your analysis. But that's about it for today. So thank you for joining us. And remember that I hope your day is not just different, but significantly different.